Hey guys, welcome to Baka Burrito. I'm Devin.
I'm Diego.
And I'm Max.
And today in Baka and the Baka Burrito podcast, we'll be talking about Castlevania because it is such a great show. And I think Devin would even call it Masterclass. And Max, would you agree with that?
I'd say my allegiance lies more towards Devin.
Yeah, the master class. All right. Now, I would just like to hear everyone's opinions on why it could be considered master class. Now, I love it. There's so many things to love about it. I'll talk in this episode about why I love it. But I don't think I have the knowledge in it to say that it's master class. So Devin will hear, will explain. Max will help support him.
Okay.
All right.
I do have a question. Would you like to like section this off? Like, we could talk about characters, music, design, atmosphere, and world building, like in the, like,
okay, yeah, I would like to, but first I would like to set it into like two kind of sections where we're talking about animation and like production wise does that make sense? Like,
okay.
Animation, sounds, and then you know, stuff that creates the atmosphere, and then stuff like story.
Okay.
Can you split it into those two? So, like, things would be, like, story would be, like, characters, the plot, the lore, and then...
Absolutely.
And then you could talk about, I mean, we'll talk about the animation, sound.
Absolutely. So, on one end, we have, like, the design aspect. So, animation, sound, and design I have on one side. That includes character models and such. And then on the opposite end, I have plot, character, like, development, and then lore. Is it world building?
Yeah, lore, world building, atmosphere, I don't know.
Okay.
I feel like atmosphere is a little bit different from world building, but it, like, lends, or it applies to world building. It's a part of world building, if that makes sense.
I'm just along for the ride, man.
Well, if you have any supporting evidence, please, please add in, because I know for a fact I'm going to forget some stuff, and...
I'll even say what's good about it and stuff, because
perfect.
I do love it. I do love the show. It's not...
Okay, perfect.
So where are we taking this from?
Alright, so if you don't mind, I could go ahead and,
I mean, we could just start with the productions. Tell me, you know, the animation, the art style, what makes that masterclass? Because I know it is.
Yeah. Like, honestly, I don't think there's anyone who can, like, if you have two eyeballs and you look at this show, you know it's beautiful. The background work, the character design, like, the way everything seems to flow together. So, everything from character design to animation is smooth. Like, the animation is smooth. Like, there's none of that clunky, you know, jumping
the weird
across
walking. The... I mean... There might be, but, like, they're so, you know, there's, like, frames, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
But,
they'd have to be so infrequent, like, I haven't noticed any, like, the combat.
It's not enough to take you out of it, like.
Correct, exactly.
Yeah.
And what I really love especially about those, like, the combat in of itself is very unique, especially when I watch other anime compared to this.
Yeah.
It's just, it's done so smoothly and, like, fluid. I feel like I'm actually watching real people fight. And it makes me want to, like, pick up a sword and go fight somebody.
I'm definitely not fighting, watching real people fight. But it is believable. The things they do, the way they Trevor holds his whip is, oh my god. Like,
they,
it's just so great to
see.
They
stick to their rules very well. I absolutely agree with that. And like you were about to say, Trevor with his whip, the fact that he uses a dagger to change the direction and he kicks it sometimes too. And he uses the fact that it's a whip so that it can wrap around certain enemies.
Yeah. And hit from other angles around them and wrap them around. And just, he just, like, it's like everything that you would think a whip could be used for, it's going to be used for. And it's, oh my god, Castlevania has this thing where it just leaves me wanting more. I just want to see more, more, more. I'm like...
I think another thing about it is, like, specifically with the animation and the powers that they have in the show, is the fact that they have the benefit of being based off of a video game that has about 20 years worth of content, like, in real life. Yeah, so... This is a so the story of Castlevania is, like, super long, but this is a small, tiny section. towards the beginning of the Castlevania story, like its lore and everything. So I don't know if they're gonna go long enough for Dracula to be reborn or anything like that. But like that happens in the video games, and it's really cool. And like, there's even games where certain characters right. Give me one second. Major spoilers for the remainder of this episode for Castlevania, if you haven't played the video games.
or watched the show.
No, no. And played the video games, because I'm going to be talking about that, too.
Okay, well, I should probably hop off then real quick. Hold on.
He said I'm going to hop off. No, no, no. So there's even characters that we have in Castlevania that we've met already in the show that are alive and well in the 21st century in the games. And, like, they're following the story very well.
Oh, my God. So I have to actually, like, keep up with the years. What was it? Year 1475?
Wallachia? Yeah. Like, there's certain characters that go, like, yo, I'm gonna just go to Japan and become a tech mogul. Like, why not? Like, you know, it's really cool. And the thing is, like, the video games, they missed out on one thing. Like, you know, they didn't always have voice acting. They were text-based. And some of the best monologues and script dialogue are from, like, just ripped straight from the game. Boom. Here's a monologue for this character. Like, and I know this is still on the production side. So, the script for Dracula, in particular, is excellent. The fact that his whole motivation is his wife dying. And I wouldn't consider that a spoiler, because it's episode one. It's, like, the first thing that happens.
Yeah.
But if you want to, you can. And his whole speech where he's like, there are no innocents, not anymore. She was the last reason on earth for me to tolerate human life. Masterful. Like, yeah. Imagine being a suicidal immortal. Like, you know, like, he's just handled in such a way that it's like, I believe that as a character.
And then even the fact that, I mean, I don't want to get into spoilers, but even the fact of how he died, it wasn't, you know, like, it wasn't like I'm gonna, you know, like, some Takano Jutsu or some, you know, an unbelievable thing, but it was just like, it's his son, dude. He's not gonna kill his son.
I would argue that there was a little bit of Takano Jutsu, but this Takano Jutsu is much more believable, because, like you said, it is his son.
Yeah, no, and not just his son, but just the type of character that Dracula has been portrayed as, very logical and obviously loving and caring, having the capacity to that. So it's like, how do you love and care so much for this woman, but you're willing to kill your son in her honor? That makes no sense. It's not logical.
Because the thing was, he was blinded by rage. Like, you know, like, he lost the person who taught him love. You know, that's it makes for a truly tragic character. And I think even that, and even moving on to the son, Alucard, he's only 17. Like, he's a teenager in an adult body. And the reason, and like, the fact that he acts like a teenager most of the time is like, you know, he's broody, he's angsty, and he's like, and this time I actually do mean angsty, like, you know. Because he has that, and, like, it's a part of his character, because he's like, oh, you know, I'm mature and regal, and I'm an adult, but he's actually not. You have anything to add, Max?
One of the most immature, characters, like, in a good way. Like, he's immature in a good way, because he makes him more believable that, like, this is an immortal man that slept for, like, a few years, and here he is ready to rumble, like, when he was, like, 16. He's, like, kind of like a...
It makes him human.
Which is something I find hard to find in some shows, because
I can't relate
as much.
Exactly, and that's even dealing with, like, human characters in other shows. Like, they're hard to believe that they're actual people. Whereas everyone in Castlevania, like, even the cartoonishly evil people, they have their motives where it's like, you know what?
Yeah, even the people in the church.
Yeah, and I would argue that one of the most human characters, ironically, is Dracula, just because the sheer pain, you hear it in his voice whenever he's talking, you see it in his actions, and just watching that, like, it makes me, like, feel so bad for this character. I know he's the bad guy, and I know, like, well, sorry, air quote, bad guy, but, like...
I don't think there's air quotes there, fam. I mean, his whole plan is a genocide.
But I understand his reasons for wanting to, though. I don't want to see him die in the end because I feel so bad for this character. He's such a tragic character to me. And I don't want to see... I want him to get his happy ending, which...
To me, I don't really see him as a man or human in a sense. I see him more as someone that's, like, above it. So, like, for him, for example, I don't see... When, like, I know his plan is to commit genocide, and yeah, that's bad, but it's, like, in a sense, he's almost, like, I don't want to say a god, but, like, that's basically, you know, they're calling him Satan all the time and stuff.
I mean, he
is. So, like, he's damn near it. So, it's almost like, he's been living for a couple years, you know, who are we to say that he's bad? Like, he's been, you know what I'm saying? Like, he's been, you know what I'm saying? He's been around.
That's the thing. This is why...
What he's doing.
This is the sign of a well-written villain. The fact that we can have this debate on whether he's morally good, morally bad, or ambiguous, or anything like that. Like, the fact that we can sit here and have that discussion, and that's, again, that's going to be subjective. Personally, I think he's right. I'm just saying, objectively, okay, he Mr. is. Isaac. What happened?
Okay,
call me Isaac. Oh, my God. Listen, just because I find myself often siding with the villains doesn't mean I'm a villain.
right, okay, whatever you say. Sounds like a monologue a villain would have, but okay.
Right? That does sound like a monologue right before.
Right before I'm about to get killed.
But, okay. So, even straying away from Dracula, because, you know, we could talk until we're blue in the face about him. If we break it down to even some of the smaller characters, especially in, like, Season 1, Season 2, you have Godbrand. And the way I think of Godbrand is... an adrenaline junkie.
And who's, like, Godbrand?
He was the Viking vampire.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah.
And he's pretty much just an adrenaline junkie, right? Like, turned vampire.
And he's in it for the views.
He's in it for
the thirst.
Exactly. He's in it for acting on impulse, in it for what's fun. And we all know, if we all have a friend who's like, yo, I don't care too much about the consequences. I'ma just... do what I want to do because it's fun. And we all know someone like that. And I think that's super relatable. Not super relatable for everybody, obviously. Like, he's played up to a cartoonish level. But, like, his motives is his own self-satisfaction. Like, I don't think...
And so all the characters move within their motives that correct. Are believable. So exactly. It's like, it makes for a...
I will say the one thing I love about his character... is when he realizes, wait a minute, if we kill all the humans, what are we gonna eat? And I just love how he has a realization. He's like, oh, hold up. Like, this seems like a bad idea. And I'm helping a man commit suicide on the world level here. And this might not necessarily be the best idea.
He definitely didn't deduce that far.
No, but I'm saying, like, you can see the gears turning in his head. The little gerbil that is the hamster wheel in his brain going. At full throttle, like, making him realize, like, wait a minute, this might not be a good idea.
And then, exactly. And even then, you have characters like Isaac and Hector, who are human, but they side with the vampires because they were wrong and shunned by society. And I think they're handled excellently, and I actually don't want to spoil their character arcs because they're phenomenal. They're phenomenal, and in two different ways. You have two people who are handled in a very similar way, and they just have such drastically different paths in the show. And, like, I think the amount of characters this show takes on is, like, 4D chess.
Oh, without a doubt.
And none of them are handled poorly.
I cannot think of one character that was handled poorly, and my two favorite characters are a little basic. They're Trevor and Cypher. Just because Cypher, yeah, couple goals, you know, like
the two main characters, okay,
two of the most important characters in the show, obviously. But I really like how they're both handled, because you look at the struggle of the Belmont family, and everything he knows and loves has been destroyed, and he has to go and save the same humans who destroyed everything he cared about.
Who would you guys say is the main character?
It's Alucard.
Alucard?
Yeah. Okay.
So, would you say Castlevania has a masterclass main character? Tell me about Alucard. Like, what makes his writing so...
So, obviously, the main cast is the trio, right? But it really
you
is
can say, like, you could say how he works off the other two too.
Yeah, so he has a relationship with Sypha because she's the most mature of the three, and they have a relationship where as soon as they start working off each other, it's like almost a professional relationship, almost like an older sister relationship, like combined into one. Like, she gets him, she understands, she's like, you know, like, listen, you guys are very similar, you guys should put your differences aside. And like, the type of vibe he has with Trevor is like, one of them is the annoying younger brother and you're not really sure who it is at any given moment.
I have an idea a little more who's a little more like,
well, if you're talking factually who's younger, it's Alucard.
Yeah, but I think Trevor acts more of the younger brother more times than anything.
Wait, what? Why is Alucard younger? Hasn't he been like asleep for like 300 years?
No, Alucard was only asleep for 1 year.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay then.
Yeah, Alucard, so the reason why they thought he was asleep for centuries and centuries was because according to the speakers, stories can come from any time. So it's their theory.
From the future, but the story,
The story is from the future, and they just got it. But yeah, so Alucard is like between 17 and like 21-ish. Because, you know, they, as a half vampire, they just, he's based very strongly on European myth of the Dampir, which is a half vampire. They don't need to feed. They're half human, half vampire. They age into a certain age and then they stop. And they have all the strengths of both sides. Hence why he doesn't struggle.
Pretty cool.
Yeah. Hence why he doesn't struggle with the sunlight. You never see him feed. He's almost as strong as his father.
Wait, that's confusing. So why doesn't Dracula need to feed?
He does.
He does. That's why he was so weak.
So what we saw was a weakened Dracula.
Correct, yes.
That's crazy.
There is a flashback where he pretty much by himself destroys a whole town. Like, with no difficulty.
I feel like he could do that now.
Exactly. Yeah. And
he's the king of all the vampires.
Yo, and the other vampires, like, for example, Godbrand was like, yo, I could tell he hasn't fed in a long time, but I still wouldn't take him in a fight.
Well, yeah, that's true.
The fact that these vampires are actively feeding and they're still not stronger than him speaks volumes of his strength, but I digress. Yeah. And then the last thing I wanted to touch on, the last two things were like character design and sound. And I think sound, what's it called? A cozy artist? The one who makes the sound effects with the weird things?
I have no idea.
I know what you're talking about, but
the sound effect person is fantastic. The amount of wallets that had to be twisted every time someone got choked or something. Masterclass. Masterclass's sound effects. The original soundtrack is excellent. I think each soundtrack, like each song on that soundtrack, plays into the ambience of every scene that it's in so well. It makes you feel like you're really in this like 1400 setting in this dreary town that stinks like shit because people are dying constantly.
And they don't have toilet paper.
It's a problem.
That's a. I like the toilet paper joke because there's a toilet paper joke in the show. Because around that time is when China invented toilet paper. But that's season three anyway. So anyway, I digress. Dracula's personal soundtrack, and just so you know, I'm gonna have it start in the background while I'm talking when in. production is fantastic. It's like, it's almost like this hollow droning sound that makes you uncomfortable to be in his presence.
And the one thing I really enjoy about the soundtrack is it doesn't just add to the scene, it multiplies the scene. It takes a scene that's already good, and a good soundtrack can not just add to it, but increase the actual weight of that scene tenfold. And every time I see Dracula roll up and hear that soundtrack, I get so I've heard into of them. it. I can't even sit. I don't know how to put it into words. It's just
sound, well,
goes
that's
so
the thing,
well.
Because sound is so important for determining the mood. Literally, not to get off topic too much, but I was watching The Vampire Diaries earlier, and there was a scene where a character I don't even like was about to die, and they played like this song, and out of nowhere I cared. I was like, oh my god, they made you sympathetic. How
right?
dare
music has that impact.
Exactly.
It vibrates your inside, your soul.
And then if we're talking about character design, because I guess we touched on sound design enough. I mean, I don't want to go too much into the detail because I'm not a sound engineer, obviously. But if we're talking character design, I think it's really important to note specifically the heights of some of these characters. Like, if you look at Dracula, he is by and away the tallest character we have, except for like a demon. Like a very literal demon, like later on.
And the demon's character designs are.
Those are excellent. Each one is like. Yeah. Even the ones that are supposed to be like clearly like the same race of demon, like there's something unique about each of them.
Yeah, it adds to.
Yeah.
That atmosphere. Like, it's like, holy like crap, these guys are actually like just monsters from hell.
Yeah, like the Nephilim demon, the ones that look like angels. Like
they
how
have like
one,
wings and eyes.
Yeah.
All around
how,
them.
Yeah, each one had like a different weapon that was like part of their body. Like I thought that was awesome. And the crossbow lion tarantula thing.
That was wild when I saw that.
With the archer. And one of them was creating was like a octopus head that created like a black hole. Like what? Why
I'm
are you
saying
black hole, dude?
I'm a soldier about to go fight this. Like
I'm not gonna
fight horde. I'm
right?
gone.
And these
I'm
guys
sorry.
Have like knives. These guys have like knives.
Yeah, exactly. It's like one of those situations, like one of those memes where it's like, what would you do in this situation? My answer is always, you know, die.
I'm running the other direction, far away.
But specifically, so back
to
the
find the apple tree. I'm just telling Mac where to run to, how to get away.
Yeah, I'm not listening to anything you say. You're using me as a distraction.
Max, go left at the fork, stop in front of the apple tree. The path will become clear.
Oh, yeah, that's definitely the right way to go.
Let's even talk about the mood that it can set. It's like, there's even comedic tones to the story. Yeah, it's dark, it's gritty,
absolutely.
There's a lot of violence, there's a lot of dark themes. It's about the devil, hell. But even then, it's still funny, and it's funny
like,
consistently. Like, every time it's supposed to be funny, I find myself laughing, chuckling, amused, entertained.
I agree.
What more can you ask for? It's a masterclass in just telling the story and keeping you entertained while it's telling it. So, like, during exposition, I'll be laughing, you know?
Yeah, just, because you have, like, the petty bickering between Trevor and Alucard. You have Sypha.
The bickering between Trevor
and
Sypha.
Yeah.
The bickering between Trevor and everyone he meets.
Pretty much. He has one-liners that clearly no one else is like, no one else thinks they're cool, but clearly he practiced those.
I think they're cool, to be fair.
Of course you do, Max.
Yeah, because I relate to Trevor.
And then you have like the magician character who he's like a pissy drunk. And he's, like, constantly just telling jokes. You have, like, these little moments where something goes horribly wrong and someone gets beat up or something. Godbrand getting put in his place is the funniest thing.
Oh, yeah, that was... He thought he was going to be, like, showing his work, showing these hands, and then...
Not what I was talking about.
Are you talking about the other scene?
People are speaking to him, like Camilla.
Oh, okay, that... He wasn't smart to begin with, so did he really expect to do anything?
Oh, his hunting scene. When he's barreling down that hill talking about some, woo! Godbrand! And he's literally chanting his name as he's running down these soldiers he's about to kill. And then he doesn't even feed on them. He kills them and dives off a cliff onto his boat. It was just a flex.
He's a Viking. He's a vampire Viking.
Exactly. It was... Oh, and they were like, oh, remember that time you burned down that village and made boats? He was like, what? I like boats.
Like, Vikings make boats.
Exactly. And
vampires don't do water. Like, that's an issue they have.
Yeah, they don't.
Wait, really?
Yeah, they don't do running water.
Running water?
Yeah.
They're the opposite of devil fruit users?
Kind of, yeah.
Funny. And that's the problem with a boat, you know.
So how about rain? Rain is running water.
It doesn't count.
The actual bodies of water.
Yeah, it has to be a body of running water. But, like, so if it was, like, an ocean, a lake that was just, like, completely, like, still.
They're low-key vague about it, right? But they do talk about it. They were, they call it something specific. I think it was, like, death by crossing or something like that. But, yeah, they were like,
oh. Take a bath?
No, they could take a bath. Because they say that joke, and they're like, God, Brand, when have you ever taken a bath? He goes, I did it once.
Okay.
But,
did he almost die? That's what I want to know.
they say a death by crossing has never happened. And I think that also, like, it's subtle things like that that also go into, like, the world building. So I guess that could be a,
Well, I think maybe a death by crossing did happen maybe when the Belmonts were rolling around doing their thing, but we'll never know because they're all dead.
Or, you know, season 4 comes out, hopefully. Keep your fingers crossed. They got 20 years of content to work on.
More than 20 years of content, but...
So, if we're talking plot in the show... sorry, I just decided to jump over to that.
You can do that.
Because I covered all of the production parts.
And we need to keep a certain time frame with these videos.
Right. So, we're talking plot.
So, if we're talking plot, right, you have the fact that the only episodes that I have any issue with the plot would be... Episodes 1-4, which is the entirety of season 1, because there is a lot of exposition that they need to cover from jumping in the past 1 year and then to present day. So that is the only time in the story I have any issue with the plot, because there are a few instances where it feels that they just jumped for the sake of jumping.
Okay.
Well, my thing with that, episode 1-4, is they had a lot to get out there in those first 4 episodes before they could actually get the story rolling. And I don't mind it as much because I know there's so much information that they need to get out and explain, especially, you know, with the apocalypse literally starting and, you know, waking up a sleeping warrior and, you know, the Belmonts trying to figure out, Trevor trying to figure out what I'm supposed to be doing.
And
drunken
it's
lifestyle.
Just 4 episodes, you know.
Yeah, like, exactly.
It's
it
just 4 episodes.
Exactly.
It's
they did, 4 I don't episodes. Think.
I don't think that's a big anything wrong, you know.
Also, no, I absolutely agree. Again, I was just voicing a minor
thing,
nitpick.
Minor nitpick I have is that the episode with Isaac in season 3, where he's fighting the one wizard at the tower.
Uh-huh.
That was such a great episode and great scene. But it was so anticlimactic how he escaped the brainwashing, if that makes sense. He kind of just put a kunai or a short sword.
Well,
like, you know, like, I wanted it to at least be like he used the magic to, like, sever it or something like that. Or,
like, he did. That's
or something super clever, but he was just like...
No, cause that he did. That was his Forge Master artifact.
Yeah, but, like, does that... Like, I didn't see... Like, they should have at least showed, like, some
like,
magic happening or
like
something, because to me,
right?
It kind of just seemed like he just pulled it off, like if almost anyone with enough, you know, tricep workout routine could do it, you know what I'm saying?
I got you, Diego.
It doesn't, like, it's not something that's like, oh, only Isaac could have survived this situation. It's something that it makes it seem like...
Well, I do, like, find it interesting that you say that.
Anyone
can
break his thing.
Because since it was...
And it's just a minor nitpick. It doesn't
of course.
It's just like, oh, okay, I guess.
I do think that there is a discussion to be had there about that scene, because I think, for example, Hector, like, at that point in the story, I don't think he could have gotten it off. I think his will was broken, or I think he was weak enough where he would have, you know, gotten
it. Oh, you think it was, like, willpower, not the kunai?
Yeah, because we do see the sign where he looks like he goes into the Avatar state, like, briefly, like, for, like, a second. And then he gets the knife up there and fights it off. It seemed more like a battle of wills. It was, in my opinion, it was supposed to be, like, symbolic, like, that his will won't be broken.
Yeah. Or changed.
Exactly.
They won't mold over
Correct,
someone
yeah.
else's. Yeah.
And
that's why I'm just saying, like, it's a nitpick. Like yeah, it could be seen in so many different ways.
But I think your argument there is valid, like, completely. Also, I will say I like that scene as the season three, that whole episode as the season three climax, with all of the climaxes of all the important characters happening side by side by side. Yeah. You know, after I rewatched the first time, I was like, I'm surprised I'm not overwhelmed.
Right,
like,
I was
truthfully surprised I wasn't overwhelmed.
Yeah.
They did it so well. You can follow, the story's so easy to follow.
Exactly.
And like, there's a lot, but it's not convoluted. It's like...
What was it? Three fights and two sex scenes happening simultaneously?
Two fights and 2 seconds? Or three fights?
No, you're right. It's two.
I think one of those sex scenes can count as a fight, but like...
Yeah. Yeah, it was two fights, 2 seconds. And actually, it was two fights, a sex scene, and then 50-50 on the other one.
You're right.
Yeah, one moment it was like, oh, I like where this is going, and then the next one, like, hold up.
I still like where this is going. For the story, at least. I don't know.
Oh, he said for the story. And then even the following scenes after, they happened chronologically. And I appreciated that. Like, you got the ones that happened before the sun came up, you got the ones that happened after the sun came up, you had the ones that happened later that day, and then you had the one that happened the next day. Like, each resolution was clearly shown, and it was, again, everything was clear. And they leave you at a spot where if they get funding for the fourth season, which I believe they already have.
It's already been approved. It's greenlit.
There's no way. This was an amazing...
Exactly. So if and when we get season 4, it's in a spot that's believable for all of the characters.
Without a doubt.
Yeah. And I just think that Castlevania is very easily one of the best anime that we've gotten in a while.
It's one of those anime I feel can go for a very long time, and I won't get bored of it at any point. Because they also don't pump out 24, 50 episodes in one go. Like, you could tell each episode is, they're focusing on each episode individually, really putting their all into each episode. Yeah. And I don't mind only getting like 5, 6, 7 episodes.
If it's quality, yo.
Yeah, because I know those 7 to 8 episodes.
And it is. It's quality.
Yo, season 1 had me wanting more so bad that when season 2 dropped, I watched it all. I think I've watched Castlevania about 3-4 times at this point, like in its entirety. I think I've seen season 2 twice, but only twice. Sorry, season 3 rather, but still. But like I said when I talked about Iron Blooded Orphans that one time, it takes a lot to get me to rewatch a show, because sometimes like I think a show is really good, but I'm like, it's too much of a hassle to rewatch. But I didn't have that problem.
Yeah, you know what it is that some shows are very easily digestible. So, like, for example, I have shows that are really, that I think are, like, the best shows ever, or the best manga, or the best anime ever, but, like, they're not, like, their rewatchability is just so low, because it's like, yo, it took a lot out of me to watch that. Like, it was great, but versus something like Castlevania, which is just, it's so easily digestible because there's so much action. I was just watching it right now, and I had my my cousin that doesn't watch anime, and he just sat down and started watching, and he's like, yo, this is actually one of the best fight scenes I've ever seen in anything. And he's not used to watching, you know, 2D cartoons battling it out and stuff. Yeah. So I was almost anyone can enjoy it, you know?
I go off the digestible.
And it's on Netflix, very easily accessible, you know?
Yeah, but to go over the digestible thing, I think the one other thing that makes it really good is the fact that there's no wasted movement in the show. There's no, like, moment where, like, I feel there's a lull in the story, which makes it very easy for me to stay invested with rewatching. Because there's some shows I've watched where you get, like, a whole 10 minutes of, like, really nothing. Or something that really...
Yeah, of, like, some sort of exposition that's just not interesting.
Not even exposition, just wasted time in the show. But Castlevania doesn't do that.
You know what's crazy, though? There are several episodes in Castlevania that have, like, 4 scenes in a row of just exposition. And, like, they're still handled excellent. Like, they're so well done.
You have that comedic, you have the characters are all interesting, and they all bounce off each other with very good interaction, where it's just entertaining to watch them talk.
Yeah, and it feels like the exposition, a lot of the exposition is also characters that are scheming. So, like, it feels active, even if it's not really active.
Yeah.
Like, just one example, and then, Max, you can make your point. Sorry, I heard you go to do it. But, like, there's this scene where Camillus is scheming with Hector, then Hector leaves, and then Camillus scheming with Godbrand, and then then Hector calls Isaac outside to scheme some more, and then the next thing we jump to is the trio. Like, it was three scenes in a row of just
and it's just setting up, but it almost seems like it's like the plot's moving along because
Max said, none of it's wasted. It's like, not only is none of the movement wasted, none of the dialogue is wasted either.
Yeah, the dialogue's so strong in this.
Yeah, and another example of nothing being wasted is in season 3 when Trevor and Sypha are, like, traveling by car to this village. And, like, they bump some night creatures and they roll up there. And then you find out what is going on in this village. You get a good idea within, like, 7 minutes. And it's nothing is wasted in that time. They have fun with the scene. They're, like, really establish, like, who could be the potential villain, who's the potential good guys. And they also leave it kind of vague with who I should be trusting in this village. Well, and what I love is they bring up a lot of questions right away. And that's what I like, because they don't waste any of that time adding in later, making it feel rushed.
Well,
because
the thing about that is they don't tell you who the villain is, because you get a weird vibe from the barkeep initially, and then he gives Trevor a free beer. You get a weird you get a weird vibe from the mayor. You get a weird vibe from the churchgoers, and you get a weird vibe from the guy who wants to carve up the night creature on the back of the cart. The whole thing just has a weird vibe, but they're comfortable because they're no longer on the road. In the beginning of the season, it's very much played up like, this might be light, this might be jovial, because Sypha, like, you're really seeing it through Sypha's perspective at first, where it's like, this is going to be a lot of fun, this is going to be fun, and then you still have Trevor the whole time, he's like, something's weird.
Hold up, I've been in these situations before, they don't work out the way you think, so I'm going to drink real quick, because I can't do this sober.
Like it works so well too, because it's it shows the experience, like, through the scenes and through the character interactions, you get the experience that Trevor has, and it makes you like the characters more because they're all clever in their own way. Where, like, going back to what you guys said about things not being wasted, the first episode of season 3 is just a fight with some demons, but it sets up the character interactions and character introductions that follow that. So they go in with the demons, so it's to show the town village that they have a skill in killing demons. So now the townsfolk react differently.
And I would even say that very first scene also establishes where our two characters are, like, in their relationship in relation to each other. Yeah. Because, like, there's a level of comfort that we didn't have at the end of, like, season 2. Like it was new to them, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, and the one thing I do like about that relationship in the show is that you have Trevor, who's the experienced adventurer, let's say, the guy he's been there, done this, like, a million times, and you have Sypha, who is more like us, seeing, like, this world for the first time with excitement and, like, looking forward to the adventure, and they kind of even each other out,
That's not necessarily true. She's never been on the road alone before. Because as a speaker, they're a nomadic people, so she's always on an adventure.
I know. What I'm saying is, like, on that idea of, like, traveling with a companion, like, salt, helping townspeople, not having townspeople, you know, try to kill you in the process, actually, technically. But but the idea, though, that Sypha is, like, gung-ho and ready to, like, help everybody, is super, like, positive about everything, and Trevor bringing her back to Earth, I just like that dynamic so much, because it really can represent the idea of, like, what the viewer's thinking, and then what the people in the show are like, no, it is not as fun as it looks. Stop.
That is true. Yeah. You do get the perspective of the viewer, which is Sypha, you know, oh my god, we're fighting demons and this is so awesome, but, like, people die.
Trevor's sitting here like, I want to, like, not do this and just retire and drink beer, please.
Well, and, that's only in, like, the first half of the first, like, it's all of season one and, like, half of season two, because, like, Trevor's only, like, that depressed, I don't want to do this kind of guy. And they make a point of that specifically, because she literally says, you look like you found your mojo. Excuse me.
That's what I like about his character, though, because it's a little more realistic than the hero that wants to just help everybody for the sake of helping.
But he's not a reluctant hero.
No, but he's more...
No. That's his calling. He's very much like, this is what I live for. I'm not so happy about it because this is going to get dark quickly.
And that's what I'm saying that I like about him, though. He's not the one that's like, always thinking like positive, like, I've been born to do this. I'm going to keep doing it. He's like, I have to do this because it's all I know. So here we go again.
He's like, I'm really good at this. So I'm going to just do it. And,
exactly. It's like that guy.
No, but I'm going to complain about it the entire way.
And you but again, it stops being that during season two. Like, very clearly. Like,
you can
stop.
Hear it, though, still. Like, even in season three, you could hear him being can't. Wasn't there a moment, though, where he's like, let's just leave. Let's just go. And Scythe was like, no, let's stay and figure this out. And he's like,
there are times where he's like, I don't want to get into these people's business.
Yes, and because they're like, I'm just trying to. The second you introduce some supernaturals, he's there for it. Like, he doesn't complain about supernaturals. It's weird.
True.
He just doesn't...
when it comes to killing Dracula, he wants all the smoke.
That's what I mean.
Dracula,
like,
once the night creatures were involved with the church, he's like...
When it's fighting people, he'd rather just leave people alone. That's his thing. He doesn't... Exactly. He just doesn't like people. I'll agree with you there. He's definitely reluctant when it comes to helping actual people.
Yeah, like night creatures, he knows that. They're simple. They're evil. Let's just take care of that.
Mm-hmm. He's like, they want me dead, I want them dead. Cool, we're here.
We're both in agreement. Great. People, I don't get. And the one thing also, like, just about season three that I love is the idea that this church is fallen from grace, and the idea that they think they found their god, actually, ironically, in a night creature that wants to kill them all, which...
They were brainwashed, right? They were already kind of brainwashed when they were shown
the path. But this is also a church that worships Dracula, specifically.
They became a church that worshipped Dracula after the night creature rolled up.
I think they got brainwashed, dude. That's what all the lights were about, right?
No.
They were screaming at first. They didn't like the night creature. And then all of a sudden, the lights are flashing. Brainwashed noises are happening.
Yeah, but what they said was
there
that
is no war. Bossing Say is happening, and then they come out and they're like, "There's no war in this church, bro. Like the night creature, that's it. You know."
No, they're like, "What's the blood over there?"
Gotta
though?
Go out to.
They were like, "Oh, your cross is crooked and it's upside down." They were like, "Maybe it's pointed the right way."
And
then also the magician that rolls up. I love that side story they add in with the magician because. I always it's kind of like the side quest.
The most interesting man in the world, you mean?
Yeah.
Pretty much. That's exactly who he is.
That's exactly the role he plays.
Yo, when he saw toilet paper, I was like, yo, why didn't you bring this back? I think this village needs it. Like, now.
No, they don't.
Yo, they do. They really did. Especially to clean up that freaking church. Ooh, the shit that went on in there. No pun intended.
Oh, yeah, the bathroom. Or in the
church. Oh my god.
Like, what bathrooms do you know of that go upstairs? Because, you know, in that time, you're not going to shit on the second floor. That's going to go to the first floor.
Yeah, that was... That whole character...
That's buried outside, bro.
Word. But the whole thing with him going...
Scythe looking cute, but remember, she don't use toilet paper.
Hold up. But I really do like the when they bounce off, like the magician and the church, how they bounce off. Like, church is trying to hide their secrets, and this guy's over here just like, I need to figure everything out. I'm here to help you uncover secrets.
I mean, you also have to remember the whole church can't read, but they have a whole huge book collection. That is the funniest thing to me.
Yo, but there was some really. Really important books in there that they didn't realize they had.
Wait, they couldn't read, or they were just not interested in reading?
A little bit of both. I think he said most of their members couldn't read or something like that.
I'm pretty sure that makes sense.
I think the main guy could read, especially because at the time in real life,
No, they were using pages of the book too. So some of them had to be able to read.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah.
You can't have a church like that and just assume that no one reads. I'm pretty sure at least one guy is there making up stuff at least as he goes while he's reading the book.
Again, we have the leader of that church there. The dude.
Make it till you make it, right?
The weird with the guy with the weird. It's almost a yarmulke. His hat.
Just,
right?
No. It's something different. I'm the final say on yarmulkes here, Devin.
Yeah, I'm so jealous, yo.
It's not yarmulke.
I'm so jealous. So back then, if you knew how to read, you were automatically a leader. If you could read, that's it. You're already more qualified than 90% of people around you.
So, Diego, you're saying I can rule a village? Is that what you're telling me?
Yes, you literally probably could.
You have to remember, Max, the collective IQ is also way lower back then, so...
Yo, so I could be a genius. Let's go. All right.
Yeah. I mean, truthfully, you would be.
Pretty much.
All right, so you guys want to start wrapping this up? I think we...
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, pretty good point.
We just talked about...
Any final thoughts?
My final thoughts are that... I believe that anyone trying to get into, like, storytelling or animation should watch Castlevania, because I think it is a good, an example of all of the aspects of storytelling done right, from sound design, character design, storytelling, character development, world building, lore, atmosphere. It does all of those so well, and it culminates into this show that it's excellent. From 4 episodes, people were like, yo, we need more seasons. And that's just a testament to how well done it is.
4 episodes and leave us wanting more.
Exactly.
You know, it's a story. If you're into the stories of vampires, there's no werewolves, but vampires, I'm not a religious person, but I'm really interested in religion lore and just the battle between good, evil, Satan, and God. That's always been interesting to me. So if you're interested in that, vampires, swords, whips, you know, demons.
Sounds king.
Magic. Don't forget magic.
Oh my god, the stuff they do with magic in this show is so...
And it's balanced.
And it's
That's
balanced.
Something I haven't heard in a while.
So yeah, if you're interested in that, the show's on Netflix. It's definitely Masterclass. It's definitely up there. It could be considered a classic at this point.
My final thoughts are going to be simple, because for the common man who doesn't want to talk about all this fancy stuff, it's just cool. I like it. A lot of cool action, really fun fights, fancy sex, like in Game of Thrones.
We've been Baka Burrito. I'm Devin.
I'm Diego.
And I'm Max.
Like and subscribe to our channel, and go ahead and leave a comment down below on any anime you think are in the same realm as Castlevania, whether that be writing-wise, production-wise, sound-wise. Let us
all
know down below. What happened?
And we'll judge
you. Oh, you said all of the above?
Yeah.
And what'd you say, Max?
I said, and I'll judge you while I read the comments.
Amazing. All right. Have a good one, guys.